You know, I see people loving animals, and I love animals. But all of these people that love animals, they need care too. And they don't get any care. So. So the genesis and the reason why we do this is to help animals through helping the people that have such pure hearts that really want to care for animals. They just deserve attention and care too. So that's what we do.
While states like Tennessee attempt to alleviate some of the emotional difficulty associated with euthanasia, there are states whose laws haven't yet matured and who accept the barbaric as the norm. As of March 2015, 8 states still use carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide to kill multiple animals in a single box. They use gas chambers to clear their overpopulated shelters. But there is hope.
There's scrapes and marks on the sides of the walls.
Yeah, how long did the space in there?
30 minutes. What happens is the staff don't like to, it hurts them. They say that it hurts them to hear the dogs crying as they're being gassed. So what they do is they would load up the dogs exactly in the manner that Karen described. They load up the dogs into the gas chamber, and then they would start the gas chamber and then go to lunch. They would then break for lunch so that when they came back from lunch, the dirty deed was already done. So she was in there for 30 minutes.
We met Grace in Greenville, South Carolina. She was taking part in the largest one-day animal rescue in South Carolina's history. And her story shows what can happen when we join together to make a change.
In the end of July, they loaded her up along with several other dogs and put her into the gas chamber, started the gas chamber, braked for lunch. And when they came back, all of the animals were dead except for Grace. She had taken the bodies of the dogs. She had taken and she had pushed them up against into the corner of the gas chamber, and she had buried her head into the pile of dogs and discovered an air pocket in there. That's probably the reason why she survived. And that's what started a campaign that ran for 4 years in order to get the gas chamber banned in Georgia. And after on our third attempt, in April of 2010, the Georgia General Assembly passed Grace's Law, House Bill 788, that made the use of the gas chamber illegal in Georgia for shelter animals.
For most involved in shelter management, killing is hard. It is hard on both the human and the animal in their care.
Now, how many years have you had Grace?
I've had her since 2006, November of 2006.
Okay. So how did we get here? Is it only overpopulation? Is it true that there aren't enough homes for the animals? Or is there more at the core of the issue? A nuanced disease affecting our society at the systemic level. A mindset that must be changed.
And then we'll divvy up our teams, and Scott will meet with the extraction team, and I'll meet with the editing team.
You know, we came in, we did this investigation 2 weeks ago. We got undercover footage. We felt we had a strong case. We brought it to the sheriff's department. They agreed, and here we are. Our head veterinarian, Dr. Katrina Hurd, came in this morning with us, and we identified that everything in here is consistent with what our original findings were, cruelty. We're gonna be bringing them out. They're in X-pens, and they're also in cages. We're gonna be bringing them out of the X-pens first. You know what an X-pen is, everybody? It's an open pen. Those guys will come out first. And once this thing gets cracked open, you think you smell something now. Just wait.
Our first stop was outside of Nashville, Tennessee, where we met up with Scotland Hazley in Animal Rescue Corps. They were shutting down an illegal puppy mill, and they named the operation Home for the Holidays. According to Animal Rescue Corps, there are approximately 15,000 puppy mills, both licensed and not, in the U.S. From these, over 2 million puppies are sold annually. This means, on average, each puppy mill produces over 133 animals every year. And an estimated 112,000 females are kept solely for breeding in USDA-licensed facilities alone.
Indignity after indignity.
The Maltese.
Typically, after a very long day, we come rolling into our emergency shelter in the middle of the night, start removing the animals, and immediately going to work, again, bedding them, grooming them, but more importantly, providing them the loving, kind touch that they've never received. We start a rehabilitation process for these animals almost immediately.
It's amazing to see the first time we put our hands on them, how scared and reserved they are. You come back a week later and get them out of the cage and their personality is completely different. They're excited about you being there. They know you're not there to hurt them. They wag their tail and lick you in the face. So it's an amazing transition from day one to even day seven with these pets.
You know, look at her wagging her tail. Come here, good girl. Come here, sweet girl. Come here, sweet girl. So, you know, here she is with a nice haircut and a sweater today, but just days ago she was existing in a box with some significant medical problems. As you can see, she's bald on top of her head. That's not just a bad haircut. That's because she had some parasites. But we're bringing her back to life now, aren't we?
Is there anything specific to this particular bust that's unique, or is it just heartbreaking because it is so similar to every single other one?
This bust is not any worse or any better than your typical puppy mill. It's a common question I'm asked by the media. On a scale of 1 to 10, what do you rate this one? I rate them all 8 to 10. I mean, there's no such thing as a humane puppy mill. By definition, it can't exist. In this case, we had a puppy mill of 100 dogs with one person attempting to care for them. It's just simply impossible. As you can see, I've got 20 to 30 people in this building at any time providing the adequate amount of care for these animals. And that's what it requires. The power of compassion is tremendous. I mean, in this rescue alone, we've had two people from different states come in on their own dime and fly in to provide a service to these animals. People ask me on a regular basis, Scotland, how do you do what you do? I couldn't do what you do. I couldn't see so much suffering without getting violent towards the abusers. And it is true, we see the absolute worst humanity has to offer. But look behind me, we're seeing the absolute best humanity has to offer as well. But I gotta tell you, the work is selfish. I mean, it's very rewarding to us to reach into that cage and look at that animal in their eyes and make them the promise that their suffering has ended because of our presence. What a gift, what a privilege that is for me. And then to bring them back here and watch the resilience of an animal, watch them turn into dogs or cats or whatever the animal may be for the very first time, selfish.
A selfish incentive to do the right thing. To feel good about helping a less fortunate being is the driving force behind many of the volunteers who spend countless hours paving the way home.
Someone's getting attached over here.
So she says, I'm going to have puppies. It's going to be good. Those puppies will never know that puppy.
From their base in Lebanon, Tennessee, these former puppy mill animals are transported throughout the country by volunteers and rescue groups, first to foster families and then finally into the warmth of their forever homes. Puppy mills are only one cause of overpopulation and animal cruelty. To find out more, we turned our focus to the front line, the partnership between rescues and animal shelters. These facilities vary drastically in both structure and personnel, from well-funded and community-supported systems to those with neither money nor support. The differences between these shelters, county by county, state by state, and north to south, offer insight into the multiple facets of our cultural care of these animals. Our next stop was southern Georgia, where we caught up with Karen Talbot of Animal Aid USA as she and her volunteers prepared for their monthly trek between New Jersey and the South.
Animal Aid is, we developed a relocation model to help with the supply and demand. And so basically we are marketing dogs from high kill areas, and we are then bringing them to areas of high demand. We left New Jersey last night at about 7 p.m., which we do every 30 days. We drive straight through the night, and we arrive down here in Georgia probably by about 11 a.m. On Saturday, all day long, it's preparation of our trailers. We have two giant rigs that we bring down with us. And all month long, I'm marketing all of the death row dogs to all of our team of receiving rescues, and I'm getting them placed. We have about 35 receiving rescues within our self-contained relocation model. People that adopt the dogs up north then want to know their stories. And because we're so connected with this end, we know the dog's stories. For instance, if a puppy was in one of the shelters and it went through a bad time, say it was dying of parvo, and it survived, how incredible is it to go into a facility, adopt a puppy, and then be given a card that you can contact the person who knows the back history of your puppy and give you a baby picture of your puppy. So it just really brings a lot of people to the cause because there's history attached, and they like that. I mean, it's like adopting a child and knowing their background. I've been asked, and many times, why do you go to Georgia to save animals? There's plenty of dogs in our shelters here. But let's just say, my whole state has tons of shelters that have beagles, and I'm not looking for a beagle, okay? My first puppy for my son, who at the time was 5 years old, I wanted to be a yellow lab puppy. Why would I walk into a shelter with adult beagles, 90% of them, and adopt one just because it happened to be in a Jersey shelter? No. If I didn't have the convenience of being able to rescue a yellow lab puppy, then I would buy one. It's just that simple. The consumer wants what the consumer wants. And so if we educate them on what exists outside their world, and we bring those yellow lab puppies to them that are thrown in boxes on the sides of roads, then you're stomping out puppy mills, because people don't have to buy them if you educate them on, no, you can get, you don't need to adopt the Jersey Beagle. You can get a yellow lab puppy, we'll bring it to you. In fact, we'll bring it to the doorstep of that rescue located conveniently in your town that you can go over and meet that puppy.